And when you look into the day of the Lord, you will find that that day is a literal, is the literal Sabbath millennium, which is to the Lord the Sabbath day. A day with the Lord is like a thousand years. So when the, when they say the day of the Lord, the Sabbath, they are talking about the millennium. And the millennium, the day of the Lord, is dreadful because it is the day when judgment takes place. And I hope that this is really sinking in for you and you're starting to really understand the true significance of the Sabbath, which is not some religious day to be remembered and celebrated, a day for people to smile and clap at Shabbat service in the synagogue, or for people to go to church on Saturday and feel like they are doing some kind of a service to mankind or God by doing such a thing. Now, excuse me. So when you understand the prophetic significance of the Sabbath, then you will understand the reason why we lift up the Sabbath, why the Sabbath is something significant. It is significant only in its usefulness. Let me ask you, is the hair on an elephant's butt significant to you? And if it's not, why not? Because it, what good is that? What is that doing for you? Does that cure cancer? Will it help you? Well, likewise, going to Shabbat service on Saturday, there is no blessing in that. There is no power in that apart. I didn't finish the statement. Apart from a significance that can be seen with fruits. And the significance of the Sabbath is the future significance, what it pictures. It is a picture of something to come. Apart from that, it is also a picture of the order within daily society, within the kingdom of God, a weekly society, I should call it, because the kingdom of God is a kingdom of cycles. You know, we often get things twisted when we speak of living with God and being in this eternal realm with God. But I am convinced that within the realm of God, there are still cycles. You know, you're not going to get to heaven, you know, this realm of you know, what we would consider and call timelessness. You're not going to get there and find out that every day is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I don't believe you're going to get there and find that when you ate a bowl of cereal, it really took a million years for you to eat that bowl. But then again, it didn't take no time at all. I don't believe that that the Lord has made a lawless realm, a meaningless realm, a wisdomless realm, a realm of no foundation. I don't believe that God made that. You see, time, God does not need to repent of time. Time in space was created for the glorifying of God. It is good. Time is good and it's not bad. God will not end time. Time is order. With time, you can measure, you know, the ages of your child or something. The fruit, the harvest. You can measure things with time. And God enjoys measurements. You know, notice all throughout the Bible, you see angels and stuff, and hey, go measure the temple, and how long is this, and how big is this? Measurements is something that God enjoys, and forever and ever is a measurement. So, you know, how can anyone prove God is telling the truth when he says forever, unless you can measure that eternity is going to continue on forever and ever and ever? Now, I don't literally think that we're going to, you know, date, you know, years like, you know, today is year 2,000 billion, trillion, billion, gazillion, million, hillion, kabillion. I don't think that that's what we're going to do. This is opinion, but even still, it is a realm where cycles are honored because, you know, the Lord says summer and winter will not cease. just like seed time and harvest will not cease. As long as the earth endures, these things will not cease. And I don't know if you read the same Bible as me, the earth will endure forever. So these things will endure forever, hot and cold, summer, winter, the seasons will continue on. Likewise, the cycles by which we rate time, because as long as we have the seasons, let me guarantee you, we will have a system by which we can call it time, past, present, and future. The big significance of being in this in the future, though, when all these things are being, you know, the same way on earth as it is in heaven, the big significance is that we are in a realm where sin will no longer come back again. So in that case, we are in the eternal realm where we do not have to worry about death or those such things. And being that we do not have to worry about death, you will find that many things in your nature will change, including how you look at time, you know, and time will not be something that you measure as, you know, I had to wait 5 minutes. I mean, who, you know, 5 minutes is nothing to a man who was in the realm of God's provision, of God's joy, a realm of wisdom and order, where there is rest and where there's never going to be any death or any curse. If there is no curse and there is no death, you know, what's 5 minutes compared to 30 hours? It's nothing, because you're an everlasting being. You have to get used to the fact that every single day you're going to be in the presence of God, and that is something so great that it's no wonder that God calls us gods, because we are the God kind, and we are made to be everlasting with Him, the eternal God. And what a privilege to know that you will live forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. You can meet every single person that will ever be born in the kingdom of God, because you have forever to do it. And His kingdom will continue to increase, and the more people there are, the more increase will come. Because 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, the number gets even bigger. So when you really want to understand the Sabbath, you must look at these things. You must see that the Sabbath is the way by which it's a way of order in the kingdom, a method for us to work 6 days. And yes, you will work in heaven. The reason why, because God says on earth as it is in heaven. And as much as God would implement work for citizens on earth, He would not do so on earth in this time of fulfillment, if such a thing was not His plan in heaven. And and that is by which we model things. Jesus came to earth working very hard, and He was testifying of the way things are in heaven. The angels work very hard, as we see in Scripture, and they testify of the way things are in heaven. Let me guarantee you, you will be working in the kingdom. There is no purpose apart from working. When God created Adam and there was no fall, He gave Adam work to do. And work is a blessing if you enjoy the work of your hand, and glory to God, it gives, adds purpose to your life. So there will be work. And God says the greater in His kingdom, in a perfect kingdom where people don't yell at you and smack you across the face when you do something nice, in a perfect kingdom, the guy who gets to work is the more blessed, because it's a greater privilege to be able to have purpose and duty in a perfect kingdom than it is to not have, you know, access to that job or that you know, that working class. And if you haven't noticed, the hardest worker in the kingdom of God is God Himself. He is servant to all of mankind, making Him the greatest, because the greatest is indeed the servant. That was not some religious statement. That is truly how the kingdom works. We got things twisted in this fallen, selfish world. But God says it is the greater, and He meant it. that does not downplay the role and authority within high status like kingship, but it does definitely reveal wisdom concerning the first being last and the last being first. So when you want to understand the Sabbath, you most definitely have to acknowledge the kingdom perspective, and that is, it is the way by which, is the cycle by which we operate in the kingdom of God, and it is also a prophetic cycle by which we will be redeemed.